Welcome back to the Nordic Championship. It is time for game two between Ventus and the Final Tribe. Ventus took game one, but the Final Tribe are looking to take game two.
Yeah, it's really the two top teams of the tournament that we've seen so far, but in game number one, I don't think they look too even, actually. I think Ventus just took an early game lead and then were able to snowball that pretty well, had a big lead throughout pretty much the entire game and were able to close it out, a lot of it, through that mid lane matchup.
Absolutely, and without Denzel really on this, Jace not having a good game at all, there weren't really that many things that TFT were able to do, even when they tried to play their team composition to its strengths. Their strengths just weren't enough, really, especially versus Priest, Kunet, and versus Pinoy, of course, down the bot lane.
Yeah, they did have a rough time, but we are jumping into picks and bans now for game number two. Could be the final game of the entire group stage, and of course, these teams are fighting for the number one spot. Securing that is going to give you the easiest matchup in the semifinals, but what's happening here can also have large consequences for the other teams that are fighting for the semifinal spots.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Final Tribe really want to be able to take this to secure not only first spot, but also making sure that none of the other teams can claw their way up from behind us. It is so even in the standings. This must be like the 20th time we say this tonight. But like, as the night has progressed, these teams have stayed even. So, like, honestly, we're just going to focus on this game because it's going to take too long to describe just what can happen.
All the scenarios.
Yeah, exactly. Like, there are so many scenarios. Well, it's League of Legends, so that's just the case. But, okay, let's have a look at the bans, as Denzel will not be playing the Jace this time around. Instead, that champion is banned together with the Lee Sin from the Final Tribe side. Ventus Esports on the blue side this time have banned Urgot and Morgana.
I think the Morgana ban is really interesting. I think it sets up for a Thresh first pick really well. Did have a bit of a rough time last game. Quickset was really good on the Thresh, but were also denied by that Black Shield coming out of the Morgana. So I think this is setting up for a potential Thresh first pick. But with a Lucian getting unbanned so far, the Final Tribe could choose to leave both Thresh and Lucian up and then force Ventus to pick one. But I think this is just going to be the Thresh with the Lucian getting banned out.
Yeah, absolutely. The Final Tribe now for Denzel, they have his entire champion pool up. They have the Cillian, they have the Malzahar. We would have liked to see the Malzahar last game instead and see Vayser up top lane on the Jace. They tried to throw a curveball, go Jace mid lane with Denzel. Did not work out. And Ventus Esports, as you said, prioritizing the Thresh first pick. The Final Tribe now up for their first rotation.
Yeah, he is such a good Cillian player. I don't think you necessarily have to pick it here. You can pick it in the third pick, so just before the second round of bans, because if you're not picking it here in the first phase, it's definitely going to get banned in the second phase. So can just look to grab a couple of power picks here, perhaps like the Sejuani and maybe an AD carry, something like the Sivir is open and it's looking pretty strong, or the Kai'Sa. It's another option.
Yeah, absolutely. And Kantos on his Kai'Sa, he did exactly what he was supposed to do in game one, but they were just way too far behind. On something like the Sivir, maybe they will be more comfortable playing the long game versus Ventus Esports, as Ventus Esports also playing it very slowly, very securely. And that can be a good thing for most games, but sometimes that can also set up for a comeback if you're up versus a superior late game team composition, of course.
Yeah, and they are actually stealing away the comp from Ventus last time around with the Sejuani and the Alistar. Actually, I believe picking them in exactly the same order.
Yeah, absolutely.
As Ventus did. So rounding this out with a Sivir would be just stealing the enemy's team cup. And there is the Pinoy Veigar. Oh, I love this.
Banned in game one, open for game two. Pinoy instantly going to pick that. And Chris Lund, of course, being Pinoy, as we like to mix those names up just a little bit for fun. Could be going. We've been talking about Olaf jungle a lot also during this tournament. Still haven't seen it in a single broadcasted game, but Olaf still being one of these strong junglers that can out-duel anything.
Yeah, it's one of the junglers that I spoke a lot about in the early couple of broadcasts, and then he was never even picked, so at this point I just stopped talking about him. Doesn't mean that I don't think it's a good pick, and with the true damage into working really well both into the Sejuani and the Alistar, and there's obviously the Cillian for Denzel.
I think this was expected by Ventus Esports as well. They're just going to leave this open and leave it for their own counter pick towards the mid lane. They still have the LeBlanc open. It could be, of course, be banned. They still have a lot of things that Priest Kunet can play to work around this Cillian. And one of those champions has been taken off the table. It's the Corki that Priest Kunet played earlier tonight.
Yeah, and I think for Ventus, you're just looking at safe solo lanes here. You just want a safe wave clearing mid lane, same thing for the top lane, to just be able to play around this bottom lane, because you've got really good gank setup, a ton of CC with his Veigar Thresh lane, and then Olaf early on will be having so much dragon control on that bottom side of the map. So banning out the AD carries with defensive utility here is definitely the correct choice, getting away both the Sivir and the Kai'Sa, as well as the pick that's still open that can dodge away from both the Thresh and the Veigar, but that is a very like scaling heavy pick, so won't be able to go toe-to-toe with that Veigar Thresh lane early on.
Yeah, absolutely, and when you have something like Azilian, you want to have something to protect, something that will go into the fray and have all of that damage, and then you have the extra utility with the Chrono Shift, and Ezreal isn't really that champion, but what is left open? I mean, there aren't that many picks that would work versus the Veigar, so the Ezreal is kind of a given one for the final tribe here.
Yeah, needs to get that off, and yeah, sure, with the peel from Alistar Sejuani and the Alistar and Sejuani and the Sejuani ulti, you can kind of keep the Ezreal safe. I think the big problem for them last game was that they were lacking damage, and this time around they are sort of lacking damage, so they really need something special from Wazer up in the top side. Earlier on in the tournament, they have been playing Kled with Sejuani, and it's working out really well for them. Don't think it makes too much sense with the team comp that they've got going this time around, but they're definitely looking to get a good counter pick for Wazer here. Kled and Illaoi are two picks that Wazer's been playing that I think would make some sense here.
Yeah, absolutely. Sleeping now again on this Poppy and Priest Conduit in mid lane again on the Orianna. So this team composition absolutely coming together. Similar picks from game one except for the Olaf and the Veigar. And I'm really looking forward to see Chris Lund on this Veigar. Now the final top lane pick for the final tribe will be revealed, and it's going to actually be, oh, this
is this
very interesting. This is yet again a curveball, but in game one the curveball sort of curved too much and came back to hit them in the face. How will this Sejuani top lane work for them?
I'm gonna say that I was gonna say that it could be Karthus top. I'm not 100% sure. I think it's going to be Sejuani top with the Karthus in the jungle.
Yeah, exactly. It's actually these two can flex, kind
can
of.
Sort of flex.
Karthus, I mean, if you start to get ganked, if you start to get dived up top lane, I don't see any way you're going to survive versus the Poppy and the Olaf as soon as the Poppy is tanky enough to be able to handle a few turret hits. I mean, what can you really do versus us? I have a feeling it's going to be the Karthus in the jungle.
Yeah, it's going to be.
Then on the other hand, you talked about him, Olaf also being one of these strong early game junglers.
Yeah, he's going to be able to punish this Karthus early on, and I'm really not sure about this draft from the final tribe. I think the big thing that they've got going for them is scaling. Like, they've got an insane scaling, good frontline, very good damage, Cillian ulti on top of that. Like, if this game goes 40 minutes, they're going to be so, so happy. But other than that, I think they're just going to be taking too much punishment from the great mid-game of Ventus Esports, especially through that bottom lane. They got a safe mid laner, a safe top laner. Like, too much won't happen there, but they've got so much gank set up into the bottom side with the everything from the Thresh, with a Veigar box as well, and then made on this Olaf. We know he's an aggressive jungler. He will be able to either try to punish Raxi in his own jungle, or look to make a lot of plays happen around the bottom lane and the dragons.
Yeah, absolutely. And I want to look at this bottom lane, because like Chris Lund on the Veigar, he has a completely different play style than the traditional marksman. He has that huge burst. Anything that he catches will simply vanish, mostly, unless of course like the Alistar, obviously with the unbreakable will and stuff like that. But it's definitely a champion that he has been wanting to play so much. Now he was allowed to. You can see immediately he locked that in. And yeah, I mean, this is going to be an interesting game too. This is a completely different kind of play style now, I expect to see from both of these teams.
And you can see this is really a signature champion for Chris Lund right here. Very well known for his Veigar. And that's the reason he was banned in game number one. And as soon as it shows up here, we're just saying immediately that is a bottom lane Veigar, because he's so famous for this champion. And these sort of mages in the bottom lane have kind of fallen out of the meta right here. But since you've got so much burst damage on the Veigar, you just really need the CC setup to be able to land all that burst damage, and that's just going to be a squishy one-shot. And with the engage and CC from the Thresh, that is definitely going to be what Crystalline and Quixith are looking for here.
Yeah, absolutely. On the other hand, you have the Zilean that can, of course, use Chrono Shift to like stop that ultimate for having the same kind of priority or the same kind of power that it usually would have. But then on the other hand, you have so many different targets that a Veigar can actually one-shot for this game. You can try to one-shot him, so you can try CC combo him and burst him or force him to use the ultimate on himself. You can burst Raxi, you can burst Kantos. So it really is up to Denzel to be on point now on this Zilean, the champion that is sort of, I feel like, his signature champion in a similar way that Crystalline likes to play this Veigar.
Yeah, I gotta agree with you there. I think Denzel's been looking strong on this Zilean, one of the only players to play it in the tournament so far. Gonna be a tall task to have it work out against all this CC on the enemy team, but will be forced to play well with these Chrono Shifts if his team is going to win.
Yeah, absolutely. Flay landed on Kantos there, a little bit of damage. You can tell instantly that Quixith and Crystalline are not just going to play a farming lane, they will definitely play the aggressive style. These two, we'll see if any death sentences can land. At this point, it's... Yeah, it lands instantly. Ignite also on top of that. No follow-up CC. Pinoy or Crystalline decided to go with the W instead, but still a lot of damage on Kantos, and the synergy that Quixith and Crystalline has together is so strong.
Yeah, you can see here Maid already looking to pressure Raxi in his own jungle, which is what you really want to do on this Olaf into the Karthus matchup, since he's got the pressure in the solo lanes as well, both Chris Cornet and Sleeping being able to come in to support him. And the big thing here is not that he's getting any sort of ahead on this Olaf, it's just that he's slowing down Raxi. And slowing down the jungle, the speed of both junglers here is definitely something that benefits Olaf, because Karthus really wants to hit that level 6, get that strong point, and now he's forced out of his own jungle, just being forced to stay down and not do anything at all.
Yeah, instead he's gonna take the Raptors though, so not the...
Not too bad.
Yeah, actually not too bad for him in that situation, as the red buff is reset, Mage is backing out of there, and I mean, Rax is gonna be happy getting the Krogs, getting the rest of his jungle, as he can pick it up. Dumble plane, no heal, that's a big difference. The CC is going to land on Nightmares, and Kantos can't do that much damage on the Ezreal this early in, but still, that's a healthy amount of harassment from Kantos and Nightmares on Quixith's Crystalline, as the death sentence, when it doesn't land, isn't that good of an ability, really, if you don't land it.
A lot of abilities aren't that good when you land them.
No, it's true, that is my experience.
Yeah, you should have experienced that.
Yeah, exactly. oh, that's cold. Up top lane, though, I wanted to talk a little bit about this Sejuani difference versus the Poppy. As you can see, the Sejuani here for Vayser not working out the way they wanted it to. Forced to flash in the 1v1.
Yeah, it's really a scaling pick here in the top lane. Later on in the team fight, it's going to be very tanky and provide a lot of utility through that crowd control. But this early on in the laning phase, like, you don't pick Sejuani because you'd want to dominate in the lane. Do have some decent ganking setup, but Karthus is not really a champion that wants to be ganking top lane early into this Poppy. So Wayser is really looking to farm, and it's not really something I want to see on Wayser. He's the strong point of the team, and as I said, Sleeping might not be the strong point of Ventus, so trying to use that top lane matchup to just farm it out for the final tribe is not something I'm too happy with. I'm starting to feel that they've been using this draft to play smart, and maybe they've been playing a little too smart.
Yeah, maybe they're outsmarting themselves at this point. Also wanted to talk about Sejuani, you know, with the synergy that she has on her E. And with all of these ranged champions on the team, and also fairly slow auto attack on, like, I mean, it's not that much that you can do to have any help to set it up. So I'm not sure about this. Not having anything with extra auto attack and melee range is not going to be the best synergy together with the Sejuani. Now with that flash also, here comes the gank to no one's surprise, and no way out of this. Vayser tries to jump away, but running towards the enemy turret is just going to bide some time before going down. The big question is, who's going to be donated this kill? And that one will go to Maid, who also picks up first blood. The Infernal Dragon, though, is up. Raxi is going to tank this on his Lonesome before Nightmare can arrive, but this is not going to be an uncontested dragon. Nightmare's tanking this. Priestland is around. It's not going to be able to steal it, though. Tries with the Dark Matter, but in the end, nothing matters.
That was poetic.
Yeah, I attempted, I wanted to go with a pun there. Not sure, did I make it?
I liked it.
Was it a good pun?
Thank you. It was charming.
Thank you very much.
Looking at the top lane now, Sleeping's been able to get that kill and a 20 CS lead onto Wayzor, who was forced to use the flash earlier in the 1v1, and then it's just solid jungling from Maid, punishing the lane without a flash. Also very good positioning there from Sleeping, staying just ahead of Wayzor, so he could not use that Q to be able to get away. But now, I want to speak about this bottom lane. We've not been seeing a lot of mages in the bottom lane for a long time, so I think it's time to have my big power spike speech again. So Sang, mages, they scale with levels a lot. They also scale pretty quickly with their items, because their items have synergy within themselves. You buy Loot and Seko, which Crystal is going for, you get mana, you get CDR, you get ability power, you get the extra damage from the Luden's proc, so you pretty much get everything you want in one item. Now, Ezreal is kind of a weird example to compare to, but compared to a normal AD carry, who really has synergy in between the items. You have AD on one item, you have attack speed and crit on another item, then you have lifesteal on another item, then you have armor pen on another item, etc. So really...
What was that with items again?
Something items, just say
that
I'm smart.
Was that another item? Yeah, you're absolutely smart, but I do agree with you, like, definitely. It's what you wanted to explain is that Kriesland will be very strong on that first item.
Yeah.
And it's going to take a little bit longer for Kantos, although Kantos, of course, gets the power spike of Divinity Force, but nowhere near the power spike of the Luden's Echo that Kriesland can buy.
Exactly. So the one item power spike for Kriesland, or even before getting that first item, even now, he's getting a lot from his item buys, while Kantos is really not getting too much right now. He's getting more of the into the scaling department. So that is definitely a thing that Ventus can abuse, trying to play around the bottom lane, get that push, get the dragons afterwards. But they've been choosing to play on the top lane instead, which is not something I was really expecting, but given how well Sleeping has been played and just winning this 1v1 with Wayzor straight up, I think it makes a lot of sense. Maid is looking for the level 6 gank here onto Wayzor. He is a tanky Sejuani, though.
Yeah, absolutely, but is he tanky enough? There's a lot of damage potential coming out of this. Sleeping tanking up the turret, taking quite a bit of damage, though, as Sleeping goes down before they are able to secure the kill. So maybe not the best play there. I was expecting Sleeping to flash there. Down the bot lane, quick set, 1v1, this Ezreal, as Priestland is no problem handling the Alistar, but oh, here comes the Requiem together with the Ignite. Requiem actually not even going to be able to get the final kill, forcing the flash from quick set. Death sentence will land, but nothing here to help Priestland, maybe being a little bit overly eager in that fight. Top lane though, flash is going to make sure that Raxi goes down, but shutdown gold will go into the hands of Raxi, so not too shabby here for the final tribe, as some misplays have just happened. There's not been the same Ventus Esports that you saw in game one.
Yeah, a lot of things happening there at the same time. I think the big thing that went down there is actually Kriesland playing that really well, actually running into Nightmares, who killed him. I think it was even accidental there from the Alistar, killed him just before the Requiem came down. So no Dark Seal, no Dark Harvest stack, and no CDR on the ulti from Presence of Mind there for the Karthus. Good play for Kriesland. Still, overall, gotta say that the final tribe are playing this bottom lane better than I expected. I talked so much about how strong the bottom lane with Veigar Thresh can be early on, but they've not been able to land the skill shots onto this Ezreal Alistar duo.
Now, I feel like Ventus are trying a little bit too hard right now to snowball the game. Of course, they are definitely in the lead, but yeah, maybe a little bit too overly aggressive here. Also, I am going to mention the redemption buy for Maid, as he, on this Olaf, decided to go with the Redemption as his first item. That was the reason why he didn't have the damage that he wanted up top lane while they went in for the gank. Still going for another one again. Sleeping tanking this up. It's going to flash away, but not again. Tanking it too long. too much, and it's going to be up now to Mate to solo this, but a little bit too early, and he's going to outplay himself a little bit with the redemption at first, not getting the heal, but that was not what he wanted. Instead, he wanted the damage on Raxi, and Raxi did not have his ultimate yet, not able to get the return kill.
Sort of questioning why didn't use the redemption to save sleeping there, but still a good play there from Mate being really far ahead in this jungle matchup with four kills going down already. Gotta say that redemption is a classic buy versus Karthus. One of the reasons that Ivern is considered a strong matchup into the Karthus is because you can't just build that redemption straight up. Same thing sort of goes for Olaf. You really enjoy that mana regen and cooldown reduction that you're getting from that item. And also, Olaf is a bit of a weird champion because there's not really anything that you have to buy early on. You don't have to complete your tanky jungle item because you don't need that damage to clear the jungle, unlike a lot of other tank junglers. So you really have a lot of freedom with what you want to build early on. A lot of times that is the Black Cleaver for the extra damage, but now it's a redemption to sort of counter out that Karthus ultimate in AoE.
All right, so that makes sense. That makes sense to me. Oh, and Raxi outplaying himself a little bit. Finally has to resort to the auto-attack to kill the wolf. Maybe again, a little bit of nerves here being on the big stage. Now getting the dragon. But thank you for that explanation. That makes a lot of sense, your explanation for the redemption, which I thought was a little bit of a weird choice in this. Now Quickset goes a bit too far again. Teleports arriving down the bot lane. Unbreakable Will is going to keep Nightmare alive long enough for the Chrono Shift to be used. Redemption used again bot lane, but not fast
enough.
Here
comes Priscorn isn't sleeping though, but they're too late, I think.
Yeah, a little bit late to the party. Fashionably late maybe. Requiem will be used trying to kill Priscorn. Priscorn able to survive that with his stopwatch flashing away from the Glacial Prison, but sleeping is not as tanky as he was last game. And he is going down quickly in this situation. And these are, again, I feel, some weird fights that we see from Ventus Esports right now. I'm not quite sure what they're hoping to get from this, but arriving way too late for this party. Someone not arriving late, or maybe fashionably late, is Quickset on the Thresh. Quick enough to be able to save Kreisland. Under this turret now, going for this fight still. Ignite has landed. Kreisland going golden. The Quickset is there. The flash, though, will be able to keep Kreisland alive together with the Guardian, but the damage will still be there, and Raxi gets the kill before backing up. Those were, I lost count, but I think, were there four kills? Three or four kills to the final tribe, I think?
Yeah, something like that, and it all stems from Quickset and Kreisland not realizing where their team are. I've been praising this bottom lane. I think it might be the strongest bot lane in the tournament, but they've been playing overly aggressive in this matchup. You had no idea that the enemy team was going to be coming in for the rotation earlier. Both Denzel and Wayzor teleported in when sleeping, and Priscorn did not have TP, so they had just had to run towards the bottom lane, came there a lot later than Denzel and Wayzor did. And Quickset, together with his team, were just bursted down. So good, quick rotations for TFT. Gotta say that the sad thing for them is that even though they were able to make that play happen, they're just 400 gold ahead in the gold count. So not doing too well in terms of that. And now they're even behind on gold.
Yeah, absolutely losing the top turret, the first Tower Blood. Here comes the redemption. Is going to be able to save Sleepy, although he was at such a high HP, I'm not even sure that he needed that help. Still so far ahead versus Vayzor, who's stuck at 59 CS, 15 minutes into the game. That is a sad number.
Yeah, that is not really the position you want to be in.
No, especially not when you try to like play something crazy like the Sejuani top lane. Also, the Hextech GLP was the first buy for Kreisland. So gonna have the extra slow CC with that, but a bit less damage.
Yeah, he's gone that item for the Glacial Augment here in his Keystone, which is why he's been picking up that item, which gives him a lot of control in the team fights later on and will allow both him and Quixus to easier land his skill shots.
Ooh,
that's a double on the bottom lane.
Double kill bottom lane. Raxi with the huge outplay on the Karthus. He sees what happens globally. He uses his ultimate and picks up the double kill. Completely outmatching his opponents. And while that happened bot lane, one would have that. Priest Kunet has also been killed. caught out of position. The steal of the blue buff as well as Mate is running away, used his flash earlier. Sleeping is about to arrive, forcing Raxi to back up. But Raxi was able to get the blue buff.
And Ventus, you really need to, like, if I was the coach of them, I would take a timeout right here. Not that we have timeout in leagues, but if we had, I would really need to pause the game right now for Ventus and tell them to get a grip, tell them to really think about what they want to be doing right now. And taking these sort of scrappy fights, getting caught out versus the Sejuani, it's not what they want to be doing. Grouping and playing around their strengths now in the mid game is definitely something that they can do, but now I'm starting to be a bit scared about this being too late. The Karthus with 10 stacks on the Dark Seal already is backing off to completely buy a Morella Nomicon right there with level 11. Double Magic Pen, 10 stacks on the Dark Seal. Such a strong point for the Karthus, and the Ezreal is starting to scale up really well as well right now for 17 minutes in. So Ventus, I'm not sure if the timing window is starting to close for them here. Sleeping is still very tanky though.
Yeah, Sleeping is absolutely tanky, but I definitely agree with you. I kind of feel like Ventus Esports are not respecting the Karthus pick for this game. Of course, yes, Vayser is so far behind that he can't really do anything, but still the ultimate that he has on Sejuani is gonna add a lot of utility. It's not the worst champion to be behind on, because even if you can't do anything else, you can still just land your ultimate and have some sort of impact on the game. And all of this early game gold for those top dives have been landing in the hands of Mate. He went with the redemption buy first, but Olaf doesn't scale that well for the late game, especially not if he doesn't have any tanky stats versus this Karthus in redemption. We have seen it been used, but that also means that he needs to be in the correct position to be able to counter out this global ultimate that Raxi has. So there are a lot of things that they need to think about, and I think they absolutely can win this if they think about him. But right now, they're not really thinking, are they? They're just going for stuff.
Yeah, pretty much can agree with you right there. They're just going with whatever they are thinking in the moment, and it's not working out too well for them so far. Gotta agree with you about the kills on Mate right now. 5 kills for the team, 5 kills for Mate. And it's not a champion that scales that well. With the Herald here though, this might be a... Ooh, he's gonna try for the solo kill on Sleeping. Won't do it though.
Yeah, doesn't have enough damage. Still able to force Sleeping to back up just a little bit, making sure the Rift Herald gets some of the HP away from the turret. Third dragon picked up here by TFT. They're gonna secure that one as well. So, like, there are so much objective focus here from the final tribe. They're playing this the way it's supposed to be played, and they're exploiting all of these mistakes that Team Ventus are doing right now. And it's just, to be honest, looks like two completely different teams from game one. It's feeling a little bit weird the way Ventus have been playing. They've gotten almost everything they want. They instantly picked up the Vega. They think they had a good Croft. They got a good situation in mid lane, as Priest could have just been farming up versus Denzel, and they were able to get all of those kills top lane, although they played them, to be honest, so sloppy with the turret dives. I mean, Sleeping dying with flash off and such, it's just weird.
Yeah, it's been looking a bit sloppy here for Ventus, and remember, they are playing for about the first seed in the entire tournament, so they really need to step it up right here. Oh, and might look for something, but Denzel on this hill, and he's going to be hard to catch.
Yeah, absolutely. Get the slow off, but Denzel's simply just going to run away from that situation. His mate, I don't think, expected to be able to kill him. Just wanted to get a little bit of damage off, but still, I mean, this game is still progressing. We're 20 minutes in. Although they are up 6 kills, the final tribe and one turret, the final tribe aren't that ahead in gold. And we talked about Ventus being a very slowly scaling team with the Orianna. So, I mean, it should absolutely still be anyone's game at this point, but the final tribe definitely in the lead.
Yeah, I do think that Ventus have a stronger mid-game team, though, while the scaling from TFT is looking really good with Ezreal, with Karthus, with Celian, as well as double Infernal, and those Infernal Dragons are just going to get stronger as the game progresses. Also for Crystalline, going with the Glacial Augment build with the double freezing items, This gives you a lot of mid-game power, a lot of sort of zone control and CC and utility in these team fights, but this is not a full damage build at all from the Veigar. And with the him being one of the only damage dealers on the team, speaking of damage though...
Yeah, Redemption is going to pick up another one. This is a huge Karthus right now, 7-2-3. In those stats, and Vayster, although we were talking a lot about him falling behind so much in CS, he's actually not that far behind in gold, so he's actually tanky enough now to handle all of this pressure on the top lane. And you said it many times before, you gotta play around your strong lanes, Sleeping definitely being the stronger player on his team for this game, but he's not that strong anymore on this Poppy. He's going tanky, of course, not gonna have that much damage. And Maid as well, not been building all of the damage or anything, not going for the Black Cleaver or anything. Instead, just being tanky right now. So, as you mentioned, this game progressing into the late stages, I agree with you that the Estreal and the Cillian definitely are going to scale, especially when Krislin not going for the big damage build, instead opting to go with the Glacial Augment style. Gonna have the zone control you mentioned, but not the same kind of bursting power.
Yeah, for sure, and you've got a question yet when we talked about playing around your strengths that, yes, Sleeping was a strong point early on, and they committed a lot of their focus down there, but getting ahead in this Poppy versus Sejuani matchup, you have to ask yourself, how much does that matter? You mentioned it, his 50 CS up, but this Sejuani is still going to be useful in the teamfight, still going to be very tanky. He did not go into the enemy jungle and put Rexy behind, instead Rexy is about 30 CS ahead. So focusing all of the attention onto the Sejuani early might prove hurtful for them. I thought that they were going to be putting the focus onto the bottom lane and try to set up this Veigar Thresh lane for all the ganks. But on the other hand, it's kind of hard to do that into the Alistar and the Ezreal. So not sure about the choice of early attention for Maid here.
No, absolutely. But here comes an attempt, the Twin Shadows. He's used to see the huge slow, but it lands on Nightmares. The Alistar, not the one maybe you want to slow right now.
Oh, the flag.
And here's Vayster with the flag. Sleeping is nowhere close to this. He has to teleport, but can he go for it? There comes the Glacial Prison. It's going to force Quixus to flash over the wall. Jet Set is going to land on Nightmare. Nightmare with the Unbreakable Will is just going to walk through it. Sleeping has right with the teleport, using his ultimate to force everyone away, and Nightmares goes down. And now Ventus Esports wants to chase down Kantos. And Kantos, of course, with me being the Ezreal, is going to be slippery enough to get out still. That is the first kill that Ventus Esports have been able to pick up in a long time.
Yeah, good series of events there for Ventus. I was a bit worried when I saw the flank from Vayster, but it did not end up working out for the final tribe. And this might be Ventus starting to come back slightly into the game. You can see that a lot of their members are pretty slippery and hard to kill. They've got the Lantern, they've got a lot of slows on this Veigar, they've got a couple of tanky champions in Sonya, some Priscornet. So they're really hard to catch out, but this is a fourth dragon going over to the final tribe before 24 minutes.
I mean, the only good thing with this situation is, I guess there are no mountain dragons here, so the only good thing for Ventus Esports is that it's not going to have any extra help killing the Baron, but still, even without that, with the Karthus, with all of this early power that they've been able to gather throughout this lead that they have, the final tribe should be able to make quick work with the Baron even without a mountain dragon. Also having the extra mobility is something we talk about a lot. It's always good to have, especially when you're running an Alistar that can simply run into the enemy team.
Yeah, for sure the case right here. Gonna be the Karthus recalling now for double needed a large rod. That is scary. Gonna be picking up a death cap at level 16 in not too long of a time. So 410 AP on him compared to 222 AP on Xpriscorn, who of course has been going for the Sonyas, but still, that just goes to show how extremely far ahead Raxi is on this Karthus pick. 1,000 gold bounty, 7-2. He's just doing amazingly well. And that last pick, which I kind of criticized, throwing the Sejuani into the top side, is starting to work out really well because Ventus were not able to play around it properly.
Yeah, absolutely. Ventus has, kind of want to say, allowed Vayster to become a menace on this Sejuani. The CS lead that Sleeping has means nothing at this point, as Vayster is dueling him with ease down the bottom lane now. And yet again, Vayster is moving towards the mid lane. Could be looking for a pick here on Priest Kunet. Priest Kunet, I think, suspects that he is there. Not going to go for it, though. Vayser decides it's a little bit too risky without enough vision.
You can see their pretty basic mid lane technique, hugging the side of the lane where your team is on, so you can see him standing closer to the top side because there's where all his teammates are. And Made, that is him trying to kill a ward up against an Ezreal, and that's not even a double tier Ezreal, that's just the one tier Triforce Ezreal from Kantos doing so much damage onto Olaf. He's not that tanky at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely, he doesn't really have any tanky stats, and yeah, not... I mean, it's difficult to say really what they're supposed to do at this point, as Ventus now trying to play this slowly, trying to scale up, but you said it earlier, versus the Ezreal, versus the Cillian.
The Karthus as well.
Yeah, and the Karthus, of course. Yeah, it's so much damage on the side of TFT, the Swedish team.
Sleeping is not here and he doesn't have TP. Oh, this is...
Sleeping is trying to run up towards this. Kantos is doing his best zoning. They could be trying to turn this around. Baron is about to reset. Nightmares has been tanking it up for a long time, taking a lot of damage here. Sleeping wants to go in for this as he moves towards Kantos, realizing that he can't. The rest of his team says no, and now it's Quickset instead, about to get caught by this Sejuani. There's so much damage, and look at the burst that Raxi has. Sleeping now on Nightmares. Nightmares still, even with low HP, of course, gonna survive almost anything as soon as he has his ultimate. Used versus Sleeping. Baron, though, has been averted for now. Sleeping is on the side, trying to stop TFT from pushing in.
Yeah, this is really close. I was so worried for them there when Sleeping was sitting in the bottom lane without the TP, still actually able to come in and time
it.
Will it die here?
Sleeping, will he die from this? Not quite. Keeper's starting, also gonna save him, but here comes the Ezreal under the turret flash. Not gonna be enough. Kantos with the auto attack in the air is going to get the kill. Ragnar rocking forward, flashing in, but the Ezreal flashing out. Now when you're an Olaf in enemy territory, what can you really do? These are desperation moves right now from Ventus Esports.
Yeah, really desperate flashes from both Maiden and Sleeping, really showing how far behind they are. And first now Chrisland and Quixus shows up to support their team, while people like Denzel were there in the bottom side to support them with the Cillian ulti, but didn't even have to use it. Wow, that is really, really important. And if you thought that the Baron pressure was scarier earlier on, wait until you see it with a Blade of the Ruined King Ezreal and a Death Cap onto Rax. This Baron's gonna go down so quickly versus this huge Karthus.
Yeah, this Baron is just melting right now. And Ventus
600 AP.
Yeah, they want to kind of do it still. They still want to try something, but they can't get close enough. Here comes the Glacial Prison. And Quickset is the main focus together with Chrisland. Chrisland trying to jump into the bush. Nowhere to run. There is damage everywhere. Nothing to peel for him. Priest Kunit is there on the side, juking back and forth, holding on to the shockwave, but he's nothing to shock. The Baron has gone down 28 minutes into the game, and this should be the final tribe able to secure game two, unless something crazy will happen, or if TFT make a huge mistake at this point.
And Priest Cornet in this game, you might as well think that he's playing Evelynn, because he's pretty much been invisible. He's not been doing much at all.
Oh!
And bat fingering the Sonius, what are you doing?
The Sonya,
this is the star player for the team, remember?
Yeah, I don't know what is happening, but this is not the same Ventus Esports that we saw in Game 1. Priest Kunit still waiting for something to happen, but look, he already used his Sonya's. The shield will just barely be enough to keep him alive, but Maid goes down, not having the redemption to help his team heal up before the redemption lands. Sleeping going golden again, but the damage from Raxi bursting through everyone, and the follow-up from Kantos as well. The final tribe going here in game two, wanting to have this one versus Ventus. Still want to stay in it, still want to stay in the running. This could still be final tribe in the number one spot of this tournament.
Wow, that was a huge game, and I think it comes down to the early game, what Maid was doing. He was ganking for the top lane over and over, really trying to put the Sejuani behind, but the Karthus was free farming throughout all that time. The Ezreal was free farming through all that time, even though they had a lot of gank set up in the bottom lane. So really weird choice of focus there for Maid, because yes, you put the Sejuani behind, but how much does that matter?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, when everything was said and done, we could see that it didn't matter At all.
Yeah.
Nothing really happened with all of that focus. Still, I am mind blown by the fact that they died to the turret twice up top. Well, actually, the third once, and then I think Raxi was able to pick up the second time around. He was able to arrive, or maybe it was Redemption. I don't remember. Raxi picking up kills everywhere with the Redemption. Also, like Quickseth and Kryslund on bot lane, not respecting the presence of a Karthus in the game, taking a long trade versus Sejuani, and then, of course, you realize it a little bit too late. There pops the purple marker on top of you, meaning that is, you just lost, like that was the fight that you lost. You need to realize Karthus is always on top of you, and Ventus Esports just didn't respect it.
Yeah, this just goes to show the power of Karthus jungle, and I'd say Olaf is a good matchup into it. You have a lot of pressure early, you can invade him, you have a quick clear, you can build the Redemption, which works out really well against him, but May just having the wrong focus, and the end Raxi takes over the game, and gotta see the mid lane mismatch, which you saw in game number one, being a huge advantage for Ventus. That was the big lane of power.
Yeah, absolutely.
Chris Cornet has been playing really well in the two games we've been seeing him so far in the during today before this one, and now he was just invisible, and Dancella was on his signature Cillian, did what he was supposed to. Gotta say, I'm impressed by TFT.
Yeah, absolutely. Dancella really, to be honest, didn't really need to do that much. He was pushing.
Yeah.
He was pushing, and he was holding Priest Kuna down in mid lane, and Priest Kuna, like you said,
he was ahead on the rotations a lot of the time.
Yeah, it's true, absolutely true. He was there to be able to use his ultimate. I mean, this is what Dancella does best, just simply playing this farming mid laner, and then rotating when needed, and being the crutch for his team. And for a lot of these times, the crutch was broken. The team couldn't do anything, and they just faltered. This time around, they have him to fall back on again. I mean, even if everyone else would have done something bad, he would still have been able to be there with the Chrono Shift. So just the final tribe playing to all their strengths, really, and a lot of mistakes from Ventus Esports.
Yeah, weird focusing there. A bit of a weird draft for both of the teams, really throwing a lot of curveballs. And I can't wait to see what they got prepared for game number three, because they're playing for the number one spot in the league.
Absolutely, number one spot still up for grabs. We'll see what happens in game three. Be right back.